going to come and share with us. It's a word that's been on his heart for some time, I know, and he's looking forward to sharing it, and I'm looking forward to hearing it. So why don't we give it up for Paul as he comes to share the word this morning.
Thanks, Pastor Pete. Thanks, Lifestream Creative people. You guys are awesome. God is good. How are we all today? That's good. Okay, this morning I'd like to speak about a subject called the light within us. Oh, you can already see. The light within us shines through. Or if you'd like a subheading to that, it's earthen vessels. I'll explain about that in a moment. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6 in the Bible says, "For it is God who commands light to shine out of the darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." And this is the part we want to get to. Verse 7, "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us." So people think that when you are saved and receive the light of the gospel, that everything in your life is going to be perfect. But unfortunately, that's not exactly true. So salvation, meaning when you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, may change you, but it won't necessarily change the outside world around you. We still live in a fallen world. But we become more resilient in times of trouble. So every day we have the opportunity to stress out or run to our favourite coping mechanism or substances or whatever that may be. But the thing is, we need to just, when we know God's with us, to have peace as we go through the storms of life. Amen? So we are not forsaken by God. Okay, that means we're not forgotten or left alone by God. He hasn't left us. That thing you're going through is temporal. I feel like that's a word for someone here today. Whatever you're going through right now is just temporal. Okay, but God is eternal. Okay? 2 Corinthians 4, going down to verse 8 now. "We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, not forsaken." There's that word again. "Cast down, but not destroyed." So the body we live in is not us. I'm not sure if anyone knows that. Maybe we could check with Hollywood or, not sure, one of the modeling agencies. But this body we live in isn't us. So for those of you who haven't heard the teaching before about spirit, soul, and body, I can just do a 5-second synopsis on that. It's we live in a spirit. That's the authentic us, okay? And so when we pass away and are no longer on this earth, our spirit goes somewhere else, to heaven or hell, wherever our final destination is. Hopefully no one in this church, we're believing everyone who comes to this church is going to heaven. Amen? And then we have our soul. So our spirit is housed in a soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions. And we renew that every day by the word of God and coming together in fellowship with others and things of that nature. And finally, our body. Like I said before, in Hollywood, that's the most important thing. Or I'm bagging Hollywood, but anyway. That's the most important thing to some people is their body. They get Botox and filler and all those things. But I'd just like to share a little story for those of you who don't know. Is I actually had a brain surgery before on two occasions. I had my head opened up from ear to ear. About, I think it's 40, if you want to get technical, 46 staples the first time and 42 the second time. And I remember after my first surgery, I just wanted to look in the mirror once I could, was able to walk again. I looked in the mirror and I just, because I wanted to see what it looked like, because they shaved my head and I had a scar and staples, and I just wanted to see what I looked like after the operation. You know, did they put my head face back together straight? You know, you think all these weird things when you almost die. And so when I looked in the mirror, I looked in the mirror and I thought, that's not me. And that's when I got a revelation that this body we live in, this isn't us. That I realized that wasn't me. It was a massive revelation to me. So we are earthen vessels. That's the point I'm trying to make today. We're earthen vessels. Some translations say jars of clay. Remember we saw the pots at the start on the screen. they're vessels. That's us. We're jars of clay. And in the Greek, that's frail, earthen, or of earth. So we're basically cracked pots. So turn to the person next to you and say, you're a cracked pot. So that's not a bad thing. That's not a bad thing. Just clarifying. That's not a bad thing. So most of us came to Jesus because we had so many cracks in our life that, and those cracks let the light of the gospel shine in. Amen? So the vessel we live in may be frail, but the treasure that's within us is precious. So let me say it this way. The vessel, our human body, may be frail or fragile. You know, we're not perfect, but this treasure, the Holy Spirit living in us, is precious. So you should say, even though I'm an earthen vessel, a cracked pot, I've received the light of the gospel within me. And God picked you out of 7 billion people to have his precious Holy Spirit cohabitating within you, within your spirit. So each day for the rest of your life, I mean, like, I hope I'm making the point that you don't have, that doesn't mean you're perfect. Okay, it's a process. I'll get to that in a minute. But we should just have the courage to know that the most powerful spirit on earth is living in us right now. That's huge. And he is also our counselor and friend. So remember, I said earlier that you're not forsaken by God. So even if you're alone on a desert island somewhere, you're not forsaken by God. He's living within us, and he can be your counselor and friend in times of trouble. So courage is the key to keep you from becoming distressed. Let me say that again. Courage is the key to help you from becoming distressed. And I have a story about that, which happened recently, maybe a few weeks ago, is I went to a lunch with some pastors at Highfields, and it was during the week, and just as we were leaving, a lady left a note on my car because apparently one of her grandchildren's door hit the panel on my car. And so I called her number and she came to the car and I just said, oh, it's okay. Is that the dent? That's fine. I'll get it fixed. No problem. What's your email or whatever? And she said, oh, thank you for being so nice about it. I said, well, there's no point squawking about it. That's weird by that, but there's no point stressing out about it or making a scene. I'll just get it fixed. And the lady just said, oh, that's great, because I said, well, where are you from? She said, oh, I'm from Gladstone. I said, oh, well, I hope this doesn't wreck your holiday. We'll just get it fixed. No drama. And then later, I think it was, this was during the week, then that Saturday, I came here to help out with the sound equipment on a Saturday afternoon to get set up ready for Sunday morning. And I accidentally scratched my bumper on my car. I'm thinking, oh, this is my week. And it was a decent scratch. And you know what it's like on cars these days? If you have sort of a scratch this big, the insurance company or whatever will say $1,000, and then the excess is $720, so you pay $720. And so even every little nick these days, so I try to be careful when I'm parking. But today, that day I had this scratch, and I came in and helped with the sound. Nobody else knew. All the team were here. I didn't come in and say, oh, you know, things are bad right now. I didn't even mention it to anyone. I just thought, God's in control. You know, I had peace in the storms of life. And so after I received the quote, I went to the car dent place. It's called Paintless Dent, so they can fix it without having to paint it. And the man said, oh, I remember you. And I said, yeah, I'm just getting that dent fixed. The lady's going to pay for it. And I said, oh, by the way, can you have a look at this thing on my bumper? I might have to get someone else to fix it as well. He said, oh, that, I can buff that out in 2 seconds. So he just grabbed his buffer and he goes, hey, how's that look? I said, oh, perfect. So the thing is, I knew that it wasn't necessarily because I was being good to the lady or whatever. It was just the fact that I didn't stress out, and if that first dent hadn't have happened, I might have had to pay for it anyway, so it all got sorted out in the end. So 3 John 2 says, beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. So to me, that basically says God is on our side. Amen? And after we're saved, it's our role as a believer to now let that light shine out. Remember we said earlier that these, our cracks, our little idiosyncrasies or issues, let the light shine in. But now, once we've received the light of the gospel, now it's our role to let that light shine out like I did for the lady that day. So how do we let that light shine? I feel like I'm in class now. So we smile. That's a start. And or you could buy someone dinner or buy someone a coffee. That's how we let our light shine in all various different ways. I'm not sure. Thinking maybe take someone's wheelie bin in. I don't know. You could do something like that. Whatever you can think of. And my next scripture is Jeremiah 18, verse 3. And I went down to the potter's house, and there he, God, was making something at the wheel. So if you can imagine a potter, when they have on those wheels and they're pumping it. I think in the old days they used to pump it by their foot, and they'd spin around and they'd make a pot. And so you can imagine God sitting at this wheel, and we're the pot. And the vessel that he made was marred or damaged in the hand of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel as it seemed good for the potter to make. So that means when we're born again, we have a spirit, but when we invite Jesus and God in to our lives, our spirit is born again and our vessel becomes new. Well, we have a new spirit in our vessel that starts to come out and work on the rest of us. So we should allow the Holy Spirit to permeate every aspect of our lives. And sometimes God just wants to smooth off a few rough edges. I'm not sure if anyone has been in church for a while and you feel that. And sometimes you feel it more than others. It's like, oh, that's a big one, God. Okay. So, and the Holy Spirit does this at the right time in our walk with him and when we are ready. So the Holy Spirit living inside of us or inside of you will convict you of things that shouldn't be in your life anymore. For example, or just maybe just things that aren't best for you. Like God knows what's best for us, but it's a process. And there's a saying, don't clean the fish before you catch it. So God doesn't, I'm sure everyone knows what that saying means, but basically what that means is make sure you get, like Jesus said when he was talking to fishermen, he used fishing as an example. And he said, when you're out there fishing, now you're going to come fishers of men. And so he brought the fish in to the boat, then you clean them, scale them, gut them, or whatever, then you can eat the fish. But we're not going to do that. But you know what I mean? So don't clean the fish before you catch it. You know, just let's get people in, love on them, and let the Holy Spirit work on them. And my last scripture is Romans 14. Is everyone still with me? Cool. Therefore, let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put a stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or sister. Well, that just means fellow believers or other people. I am convinced, being fully persuaded in the Lord Jesus, that nothing is unclean in itself. But if anyone regards something as unclean, to that person, it's unclean. In other words, some Christians can handle doing certain things while others can't. I'm not sure if anyone's been in that situation. You think, oh, Lord, what is... I'm not pointing to you, Sal. But, Lord, what does that person get away with doing that? And I can't. And the Lord will say, well, you might feel a nudge. And you'll just feel, well, you used to have a problem with that. That's why you can't do it anymore at all. You know, just you need to stay away from certain things. And so the Holy Spirit convicts us each individually. Some people call it your conscience. But when you're saved, it's your the Holy Spirit can just give you a little nudge. I know I'm saying he, but the Holy Spirit is a gentleman. He would just nudge you about certain things, and you go, oh, maybe I'm not going to watch that show with wizards anymore, or, you know, I'm casting spells, not sure, whatever it may be. So we are not living under the law, but under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And I just feel led to say that, hopefully, I just feel some people might understand it better this way. We don't necessarily have too many rules in our church, if that makes sense, but... So we don't say, if you want to join Lifestream, you have to do this, 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 and this. But what happens is when you're saved and you have the Holy Spirit in you and you read through the Bible, then it's actually gives you, rather than living by the law, it gives you a higher level of, because God's sorting out each person, he meets us where we're at. Amen? So some people go around preaching their own personal convictions, meaning things that God's working on them about. But God is just telling them, not necessarily everyone in the church. And there might be a new visitor. We've had some new visitors this morning, which is awesome. It's great. So there might be a new visitor come in to the church. And if we start telling them to cut their hair or stop watching television or stop listening to rock music, how long do we think they're going to last in the church? That's a trick question. Not long. And so We need to obey the commands of Jesus in the Old Testament. So our Bible, one's under the seat. But we need to obey the commandments of Jesus, what he said in the New Testament. But we also need to especially obey the command to love others. So it's more than just Bible bashing, people saying, come to church, get saved. It's just everything Jesus did when he was on the earth, he did it in love. He helped out people, and he might have been on a way to a meeting or somewhere, and people would stop him, and he'd never say, no, I'm in a hurry. Jesus would say, oh, okay, what's going on? He said, what can I do for you? And he said, the blind Bartimaeus said, I'd like to see. And so Jesus would take time out to pray for people. So Jesus would always look through the lens of love for people, and I believe that's an awesome thing for us to do. So you may be an earthen vessel, but you are filled with the power of God's glorious light. And so what I'm saying today is we need to let that light overflow in you. Because Christ, the hope of glory, lives in you, and there's nothing you can't do. So if there's people who've said things to you in your life and spoken negativity over you, you'll never amount to anything. Or I think people like Winston Churchill and Einstein and a lot of people were told by their teachers, you'll never amount to anything. And I believe that there's nothing we can't do with the help of God when he's in our boat and the Holy Spirit. Amen? So finally, I'll make my last point, and then I just want to share some things I have from the Lord. I just want to say in closing that God is with you. You will not be destroyed. All you need to do is make a choice every day to overflow in his love, his word, and in his light, and allow the light within us to shine through. Amen? So now, just before I hand over back to Pastor Peter, I just had a couple of words of knowledge from the Lord. And what we're going to do is we're going to open up the altar after Pastor Peter's given an invitation. We're just going to open up the front here for anyone who needs prayer. And I just felt like someone here today, you've been having a problem with your right hip, kind of down your right leg here. And we just want to pray for you and believe God's going to heal that today, because it's just something that God's revealed to me. That's called a word of knowledge. And also, someone's had a problem with their right arm too. I think it's maybe coming down their shoulder as well, but you've got a bit hard with the microphone, sorry. Someone has an issue with their right arm here today as well. And God can heal any of these things anytime. But God just revealed those couple of things to me this morning just to help spark your faith to believe for your miracle. Amen. So now I'm just going to hand back to Pastor Pete. He's going to give you an invitation.
Yeah, thanks for that. That is great. And if someone identifies with those things that Paul mentioned and you want to come for prayer, just do that in a moment. I had this just picture in my mind, I guess, as Paul was sharing of, the cracked pots, and that we all have cracks in our life, things that are wrong with us. And I could just imagine this, like the light of God inside of us shining out through the cracks, actually. And it's easy for us to look at a person and see the cracks, isn't it? But what we need to do is see the light of God shining through them. Because we probably can't change their cracks. It's got to be, we've got to let God do that. Let God change that in that person. And we can see his goodness that's on the inside of each person. Look for the goodness that's there. Look for the good things that are in of God inside each other. That's great. So I want to give an opportunity here before we close. Maybe we just close our eyes for a moment. As Paul has been sharing today about God coming to live inside of each one of us. And I don't want us to close without having that opportunity, because just about every week here at Lifestream, people are responding to God and saying, yeah, I want to give my life to God. I want to take that opportunity to ask Jesus into my life, that he would live on the inside of me. The fact is, folks, we all need God. And we all have things that separate us from God. And when Jesus comes in, he takes away the sin. He forgives us. He forgives the sin that blocks us from a relationship with God. And he says, I want to welcome you into my family. And if you're just sensing this morning that there are things that are a blockage between you and God, and today you want to ask for his forgiveness, you want to ask him to come into your life and change things on the inside, this is a moment right now where you can do that. We can say, yes, would you please pray for me? I want to ask Jesus to come into my life. Just while every head is bowed, no one's looking around. If that's you, if you're sensing that right now, why don't you just raise your hand. I'll see it. You can put it down again. Because I don't want us to move on until we've given that opportunity. If someone is saying today, yeah, that's me, would you pray with me?
Before I knew perfect love, my heart was a mess until you.